Hi everyone, today I'm going to go through laryngeal mask airways, also known as LMAs or supraglottic airway devices. So let's get started. So the first disclaimer, obviously patients who are hypoxemic or not ventilating well, these are high risk situations, and the LMA again falls in the context of a whole plan for resuscitation. So first of all, I like to give, like with all my talks, a strategy and a framework for the way that I'm going to be approaching this. So I imagine that airway management is really trying to optimize oxygenation ventilation through any of these means, bag mask ventilation, intubation, and we've got a couple of videos for that, as well as the LMA. Now, if these aren't working and we're in a can't intubate, can't oxygenate scenario, then you'll be thinking of a surgical airway or front of neck access, which is a whole other topic as well. And you'll definitely need to be calling for help and only doing things that you're comfortable doing and know how to do it, and also manage the problems and complications that could occur. So with that in mind, let's get started with LMA ventilation. So a laryngeal mask airway is really a device that just sits over the trachea and the laryngeal opening. And this then creates a seal which allows us to positive pressure ventilate. So again, just like the bag mask or the intubation, what you're doing is you're creating a seal with a certain structure and then using positive pressure to ventilate through this tube and inflate the lungs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to demonstrate on this airway anatomy model. So again, where I'm going to place this LMA really is just sitting past the tongue with the opening and aperture just above where the cords are. And that way you'll get ventilation down this tube and into the airway. So the next thing we're going to go through is insertion technique. Now that you've seen where the LMA sits in that anatomical model, you can probably make sense of what you need to do. So essentially, there's a couple of different ways that you can insert this LMA, but the most common one is to push it past the tongue straight back. So what I do is I usually open the head just like that. So do a head tilt that opens the mouth. Often you can get your assistant to just open up the mouth like so, and that allows you to place this in. You need, the minimal aperture that you need is about 2 centimeters. So just remember that if you have a patient with very small or limited mouth opening, you'll need a low profile, potentially like a fast track LMA, to make sure that you're able to get it through. To 2 centimeters, probably the bare minimum you need. So I've got the mouth open, I push it back. Now the first resistance you're gonna get is the tongue. So you really, sometimes you get a resistance there that doesn't allow you to place it. So what I have to do is I just need to apply a light bit of pressure, and that then sits correctly, and you'll feel a bit of a pop and a rise in the larynx as that goes down. So just to demonstrate that insertion again, I tilt the head back. I might get an assistant to open the mouth or even try to open it myself. I push it past the teeth gently, and then I'll push backwards so it goes along the upper palate, the hard palate, and then down the soft palate past the tongue. Again, sitting just above the airway, the trachea, which allows ventilation. Again, as always, I check ventilation. You can see the rise and fall of the chest, and sometimes that's all you need. Other times you'll inflate the cuff, and it's already got some zones marked out. Essentially, you want to inflate that cuff and try to create a better seal. So one of the common things that happens is that as you place the LMA in, sometimes it just gets stuck at the posterior pharynx. So what you need to do is sometimes follow the curvature of your hard and soft palate and then push it around the tongue. So I'm actually forcing backwards with a bit of pressure, and that allows it to get past the tongue more easily. So that's one of the first things I do. Again, there's many ways that this can go wrong. So really, no matter what you're doing, you have to continuously assess that you're ventilating, so rise and fall of the chest, and that you're getting fogging in the tube and hopefully end-tidal CO2 trace, as well as the saturations are appropriate and safe for this patient. So let's say you're trained to put an LMA in and you've put that LMA in and you're trying to ventilate this patient, but you simply can't ventilate. For example, there might be an obstruction or it might be too great a leak. So I've got a few things that I can do. And as I mentioned in a few of my other videos, the common things are I could position the patient better, or I could provide paralysis. Again, paralysis can be very tricky. You've got to know how to manage the complications of paralysis before giving any of these very dangerous drugs. So positioning paralysis are the ways I can optimize any of these airway situations. That specifically for LMAs, just like with having a mask on your face or an endotracheal tube, the size and the type are mainly the things that I can adjust. So this one I've got as a size 4. If there's too much of a leak, I can either use a size 5 LMA, so go up in size, or put a bit more air in the cuff. Generally speaking, you want to go for a higher size and put less air in the cuff. That just minimizes the chance of trauma to the airway. So if I've tried a different size LMA, it just doesn't seem to fix the problem. I can then try a different type of LMA, whether it's a ProSeal, a Supreme, or an iGel, or one of the newer devices that will be out in the market. So thanks very much for watching. This is ABCs of Anesthesia. We've gone through LMAs, the optimization, the strategy, how to troubleshoot. So I hope that was interesting. Please share with anyone who might be interested, and I'll see you next time.